Hi, I'm Linda Evans Parlette, your state senator from the 12th Legislative District. This is an exciting day for me because I get to go home. The regular session is over, the special session is over, and the one day of the second special session is over. We're in the Senate chambers and it's very peaceful. It wasn't like this 24 hours ago. This has been a phenomenal year, and the learning curve for me this year was probably the steepest. And let me tell you why. As most of you know, I am caucus chair for the Senate Republicans. And for the last 2 years, I'm also the Republican lead on the Capitol budget. Well, unfortunately, our minority leader, Senator Hewitt, had surgery about the second week of April. So that put me into the position of also acting as minority leader. So I was wearing three hats on several days. And in the end, it was a big load. But I certainly learned a lot. I would say the highlight of the session for me was being part of the team that met multiple times in the governor's office. And I give our governor credit for helping bring all sides together in the end. As you know, the Senate Republicans said right from the beginning, we want a sustainable budget and we want reforms before revenue. And that meant long-term structural reforms, reforms before revenue. As the governor said today in her media availability, how can you have reforms before revenue and also negotiate on a budget? It doesn't work. And it didn't work. We did need the governor in the end to bring all the players together and look at all of this as a package deal. It meant a sustainable budget, it meant reforms, and it also meant a capital budget. And we would agree we would have all of those. And by looking at it as a package deal, people came together. So let's talk about that. First of all, the budget does not have enough in reserves, but that was part of the agreement. The budget that passed here on the floor of the Senate early in the morning on March 3rd, when we had three Democrats join 22 Republicans to pass a budget, had a reserve of about $501 million. The budget that passed this year does not have that. The governor today in her media availability said that she will have to make some vetoes in the operating budget because she wants more of a reserve. What she chooses, it's hard to say. Why did 22 Republicans and three Democrats pass a budget on March 3rd? Because the majority party in the chambers here did not have 25 votes. That's what it takes in the Senate, 25 votes. So we broke a logjam by passing a budget at early in the morning on March 3rd out of the Senate. There were a lot of hard feelings, a lot of hurt egos on the side of the majority. So nothing really happened the next week. But eventually, people got over it, and we all started to work together. So let's talk about the reforms. What are those reforms? Well, one of them passed in the regular session, and that had to do with teacher performance evaluations. I won't go into the detail, but the important thing to say is that we have some pilot projects going on around the state, and we will use the results of those pilot projects, but move it into a format that perhaps we can accomplish that reform earlier. And the reforms in the special session, what were they? Well, one of them is a four-year balanced budget. There is no other state in the union that has that. How will we get there? Well, we will work on a balanced budget for 2 years like we always do when we put out an operating budget. And then the third and fourth years, we will assume a revenue growth of 4.5%, which is what we do now, and then try to take the other assumptions and make them visible and see if that will work. Now, many people say that was watered down from the original form, but you know, I think that's okay because no other state has ever done this. Let's go a little slower, try to do it right, and learn from it. If it's going to be really successful, maybe it can be a constitutional amendment in the future. But right now, that bill is just in statute. The second reform was pension reform. Why is that a good idea? And why did it take so long to get there? It took so long to get there because the Senate Republicans felt that long-term pension reform is necessary. And the Democrats felt our pensions are in good form already. We don't have to worry. But there was agreement once the facts were presented that long-term sustainability is going to be a problem. When we look at our pensions, we are assuming an 8% revenue growth rate. Well, I don't know who's getting that from the stock market these days, but not very many people. So bottom line, again, without going into detail, future state employees, if they retire early, they will have their pension reduced by 50%. If they choose to retire early, they will be able to pay in more if they want, and then that will help that. Or they can wait, because the longer you don't take your pension, then the more the larger size of a pension you will get. Little bit complicated, those details we can get to you later if you're interested. And lastly, the reform that took quite some time was looking at the K-12 employees' health care purchasing. We have 295 school districts in this state. I would say, as a former member of the Blue Ribbon Healthcare Committee, it is called fragmented purchasing. Everybody's doing their own thing. We learned from the Blue Ribbon Healthcare Committee that the state has to be a smarter purchaser of healthcare. So the most important reform in the bill that had to do with school employees' health insurance was a method to collect the data so we will know what the school districts are doing, and we will be able to make an educated decision in the future, is there a better way to do it? Another part of that bill said that all school districts will provide health savings account as an option to school employees. Also, the school districts will provide one of the health care policy insurance choices that the PEB members have. That means state employees who buy health insurance through the PEB, the Public Employee Benefit Board. We also included a formula so that long-term, it is called a 1-to-3 ratio. We will work toward that ratio. So the cost of health care insurance between single people and families won't be over that ratio. We will work to get there. So let me tell you, I have had 4 hours of sleep yesterday after being up all night, and 5 hours of sleep last night. So I guess it's okay if I can't remember all the details. I have just returned from the media availability that the governor had. I have to give her credit again for bringing all sides together. I have never been to the governor's office as many times as I have in the last 48 hours. I was there at 2:00 in the morning yesterday, along with Speaker Chop, Lisa Brown, Richard DeBolt, all the leaders, wearing my hat as minority leader. And in the end, the last bills to pass, the capital budget, which I worked on early in the morning 2 days ago. Luckily, we got that done. And the constitutional debt amendment. I was the prime sponsor of that because I do believe changing the constitutional debt limit from 9% down to 8% is a very important thing to do. We are a high debt state. We've got to rein that in, and I'm hoping that the taxpayers and the voters, when they look at that in the voters pamphlet, will certainly call if they have questions, because I know that one by heart. As always, it is a privilege to represent you. I am proud to represent all the people of the 12th Legislative District, and I'd like to add, now that redistricting has occurred, after November, we will be the largest district in the state. We still will include all of Chelan and Douglas County, but we will be picking up more of Okanagan County and more of Grant County. So we will expand. My car will have more miles on it, but I'm very proud to represent all of you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to be your state senator.